He is the way, to the dead he is the life, to the liar he is the truth, to the prayer he is the amen, to heaven he is the firstborn, to the sheepfold he is the door, to the mighty he is the almighty, to time he is the ancient of days, and to the hungry he is the bread of life. His name is Jesus. To the sick he is the good physician, to the thirsty he is the water of life, to the sinner he is the author of salvation, to the heavy laden he is the burden bearer, to the builder he is the chief cornerstone, to the servant he is the good master, to the sheep he is the good shepherd, to the wayward traveler he is the good Samaritan. His name is Jesus. To the alphabet, he is the Alpha and the Omega. To the orphan child, he is the everlasting Father. To the lonely, he is your friend. To those in darkness, he is the light of the world. And to the theologian, he is the author and finisher of our faith. His name is Jesus. He was born in a borrowed stable and laid in a borrowed manger. He preached on a borrowed boat. He fed thousands with a borrowed lunch. He rode as king on a borrowed donkey. He observed the Last Supper in a borrowed room. He was mocked as king in a borrowed robe. He was crucified on a borrowed cross. And he was buried in a borrowed tomb. But early Sunday morning, when the women went to the tomb, they found that the stone had been rolled away. Jesus had rolled away the rock that sealed the rock, that entombed the rock, that was the rock of of ages, and the Rock of ages walked out of the rock with all power in heaven and earth in his hands. He had saving power, deliverance power, healing power, redeeming power, and Holy Ghost resurrection, resurrection power. He rose from death. He's alive, and he's coming back again. You see, the resurrection isn't just an event. It's a person. His name is Jesus. What a beautiful name.
This is what they felt like when it happened. And today, it's how we should feel too. Because what it meant for them, it means for us.
So let me have you stand. And one of the reasons that we gather here in person, online, is to turn up the volume on our notifications, so that we hear again in fresh ways how powerful this day is and how it changed everything for us, for our church, for our city, our county, our state, our nation, the world, eternity. And the church for 2,000 years has been doing a tradition where someone stands up front and says, "He is risen," and this is your practice, and the people respond. So we're going to do this three times together, and just turn the notifications up in our spirits to hear again this amazing good news that He is risen. All right, He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. Jesus, thank you that you rose from the dead, that this day changed everything. And turn up the volume so we hear that notification in fresh ways today. Amen.
God so loved the world. Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Oh, come all you sinners, come find His mercy, come to the table He satisfied. Taste of His goodness, find what you're looking for. For God so loved the world that He gave us His one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in Him will live.
Church, Why don't we give it up and for Jesus one more time? Amen. Amen. How many are excited about God's love? And I don't know about you guys. I don't know if it's the Holy Spirit or the Holy Espresso, but I am feeling jacked this morning. You may be seated. Whether you're visiting us for the first time here or online, we want to welcome you to Easter at SVCC. Man, it feels so good to be able to say that. You guys excited about Easter? Man, so if you're new, by the way, if you're watching us online, click on the new to SVCC button. We have a gift just for you. How many have been enjoying our Emoji Jesus series? Just raise your hand. Just do it. Just raise your hand. Yes, everybody. Amen. It's been such a blessing. Mark, you see that wherever you're at. This has been such a blessing. And we're going to have another blessed series for you guys. We're entitling it Psalm 23. We're going to dive into this psalm and verse by verse every Sunday. We're going to take a look at that. So we're praying that God would speak to you and just incredible ways, as we know he will. We have small groups starting also as we're starting this new series. So if you're not in a small group, we want to encourage you to jump into a small group. We believe that community is so important. We weren't created to do life alone. We were created to do life together. So if you want to jump in a small group, please contact Paul Richards at paulr@svcc.net. Now, before we get back into worship with music, we want to give you an opportunity to worship by bringing back to the Lord. And so here at SVCC, we have three ways to give. You can text to give, you can give online, or you can mail your check to our church office. And for those who are here, you can also, there's some boxes on your way out. You could just drop your offering in one of the boxes in the back. All right, let's get back to worshiping the Lord with music. Amen. God bless you.
You are not hidden. There's never been a moment you were forgotten. You are not hopeless. You have been broken, your innocence stolen. I hear you whisper underneath your breath. I hear your SOS, your SOS. I will send out an army to find you in the middle of the dark. Distance that cannot be covered over and over. You're not defenseless. I'll be your shelter. I'll be your armor. I hear you whisper underneath your breath. I hear your SOS, your SOS.
So that song, thank you so much, worship team. That song that Alex started, the lyrics of that song that she just sang start this way. You are not hidden. There's never been a moment you were forgotten. You are not hopeless. And that really is going to be the theme of the next 6 weeks, just to expand a little bit on what Mike shared. Psalm 23, probably one of the most familiar parts of Scripture. And we're going to talk about not just up here, that these truths that David talks about, but here, like experience, drilling down. How do we open ourselves up more to this reality that every moment of our lives, we're being shepherded, watched over, cared for? And one of the ways that God shepherds us is through other people, to shepherd one another. And life change happens best in small groups, in circles, in community, on Zoom screens, you could say now. But life change happens best when we're with other people and we're sharing our lives together. One of the ways that God shepherds us is through other people. So that's why we really encourage you, start with family maybe, invite a friend or two. Every week we're gonna provide the questions for you, and you just have an opportunity to connect with other people and talk about how it is that God is teaching you to be a sheep who's aware of the shepherd. And if you haven't been with us for a while, or this is your first Sunday here, or however it is, we have been going through this series, Emoji Jesus, and we've been talking about the fun emotions that we love that Jesus had when he came here to earth, loving, hopeful, you know, things like that, but also some difficult ones, angry, misunderstood, anguished. And so we've been talking about the whole spectrum of emotions that Jesus experienced, and today is sort of, it's a standalone message, but it's really also a culmination of this whole series, because the emotion we're going to talk about today that Jesus experienced through his death and resurrection, and actually starting in Palm Sunday, is triumphant. Triumphant. That's the emotion we're going to talk about today. So triumph is a victory or conquest by or as if by military force. So to feel triumphant is to experience this incredibly deep satisfaction of conquest, of victory in some way. Lauren Daigle's song that was Alex just sang has another section to it that says, I will send out an army to find you. In the middle of the darkest night, it's true, I will rescue you. I will never stop marching to reach you. In the middle of the hardest fight, it's true, I will rescue you. So the army that God sent to rescue you was an army of one. He became the army, became one of us, lived a life here among us, a perfect sinless life, so that we could get to the events of this week, ultimately, of his coming into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday triumphantly, of the betrayal and every horrible thing that happened on Good Friday, but then at the end of the week, today that we remember, and beyond Easter, there was triumph, there was victory. So we're going to talk about this Holy Week as a three-act play. Today, Easter Sunday, is the third act. So the first act is when Jesus is credited as a coming king. You very rarely get alliterative sermons from me, so I just want you to notice like how much effort I put into these points, that they all start with the same sound. Credited as a coming king. So we have this story of Jesus coming into Jerusalem on a borrowed donkey, and everyone's laying down their palm branches like, the Messiah's here, the Son of David, yeah! By which they meant, throw the Romans out, take over, rule again from Jerusalem, which Jesus was going to do, but in a way that they didn't quite expect. So the end of that description says, most of the crowd spread their garments on the road ahead of him, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Jesus was in the center of the procession, and the people all around him were shouting, "Praise God," literally Hosanna, which means rescue us, but also came to mean to praise God for being the rescuer. "Praise God for the Son of David," a title for the Messiah. "Blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Praise God in highest heaven." So the week started off awesome, with a triumphant feeling. And so often in the last year, which has been a very difficult year, it didn't strike me until this week. I go, what did we do last Easter? I forgot that we did last Easter purely online. Like, I erased that from my memory because of the trauma, I guess. And like, this is a huge step forward. Who thought it would take this long to get here? But a huge step forward. And this has taken so much longer than anyone could have predicted. Really, just amazing. So I'm wondering, like, when have you felt triumphant recently? And I had an emotional experience recently that really surprised me. So I've been wanting to get this vaccine for a while. So I heard, like, if you go to Natividad Hospital, at the end of the day, they have leftover doses, and you can, like, wait and get on a list. Yeah, you did that. I saw. Didn't work for me. So I went there. I'm sitting in the bitter cold of the Salinas, you know, March and February, trying to wait for my dose. And they always had doses every time. And then they go, okay, anybody over 80, 75 to 80, 70, you know, I'd be like, it's the only time in my life since I've been a child that I actually wanted to be older than I was. Like, dang, what about 58-year-old asthmatics? Do we get, when do we get? No, never got down to my age. So I was just like frustrated by this experience. And so I'm praying, you know, like, how is this going to work out, Lord? And so how it worked out for me was, now I could get one as of April 1st, but how it worked out was there's a pastor that I know whose wife has the ability to schedule people for things, and she's like, y'all are essential employees to me, and you're old. Believe me, she's young. She's like, you're really old, and yes, we're going to get you a vaccine. So I actually have my first dose, like, well, tomorrow's my second dose, so almost 3 weeks ago. And when I got the, I was talking to the husband, he's like, how late can she call you tonight? I'm like, dude, I'm going to turn my phone up. She can call me at 2 in the morning if she gives me an appointment. Like, yes, I am ready. So she calls late that night, and I got off the phone after having my appointment scheduled. And I realized people have different feelings about the vaccine, but for me, I was just like surprised by how joyful I felt. Like, this is a feeling of resurrection. Like, my life can come back and the people I love, and I can start sitting with people in my office, and I can't wait. Because the last year has been hard to be a pastor, like talking to a camera and living a life that I understand why we're doing it, but it's not how God created us to live. It's been so hard for all of us. And that feeling of resurrection coming and starting to come in our world, actually, was such a thing. When I got the shot, I left. I was just like so emotional, so hopeful. So I planned out. I'm like, okay, I got Pfizer, so I got 3 weeks. And then I'm like 2 weeks after that. And I'm like, we're going to go on an anniversary trip in May. So last year was our 35th anniversary. And we had, like, the biggest trip of our life planned. Anybody have any trips planned last year? So, yeah, we went camping once. Sat around a campfire with some people. I like camping. It's not the same as going to Italy, which is where we were going for our 35th. So, yeah, isn't that sad? And we're not going to Italy this year either, but we can go somewhere. We're going to go on an anniversary trip, drive around California and enjoy ourselves. But that feel, maybe you've had a feeling. So my question is, what is your triumphant level these days, and do you have any great things to celebrate? What great things have happened in your life that you're bringing a feeling of being triumphant about, like something that's been accomplished or something that you've been blessed with? I just want to give you a moment of quiet with God to to reflect. Maybe you're already aware. Just thank you, Lord, for that feeling of this great blessing and triumph that's come into my life. Maybe you don't know what it is. Maybe you're not aware you even have anything to celebrate. Well, just say, Lord, I don't feel like I do. Show me. So I'll give you a moment just to reflect with the Lord. So, Father, thank you that even in difficult times, you are always at work, and there is always some kind of blessing you are pouring into our cups. Amen. Well, I saw this headline this week that was about COVID, and it was like this race between the vaccines and the variants. And the headline said this, "Hope collides with dread." And I thought, boy, if that isn't a description of Holy Week. So it starts with hope on Palm Sunday, and it ends with hope on Easter, but in the middle, whew, Good Friday, hope collides with dread. So that's Act 2. Act 1, credited as a coming king. Act 2, crushed as a common criminal. Because Good Friday does happen in the middle of this week, toward the end of it, dark, abandoned, betrayed, mocked, falsely accused, judged, tortured, crucified. And Jesus came into this world knowing that awaited him because he loves you. He loves you. And he knew coming here that that was on God's agenda. Isaiah 53, in the scriptures that he knew so well, prophesied this 700 years before. Yet it was our weaknesses he carried. It was our sorrows that weighed him down. And we thought his troubles were a punishment from God, a punishment for his own sins. But he was pierced for our rebellion, crushed for our sins. He was beaten so we could be whole. He was whipped so we could be healed. All of us, like sheep, have strayed away. And that's why we're going to talk for 6 weeks about what it means that God's our shepherd, because we're the sheep that wander looking for things that will never satisfy us. And he's the shepherd always bringing us back. We have left God's paths to follow our own. Yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all. He had done no wrong, had never deceived anyone, but he was buried like a criminal. He was put in a rich man's grave. And I love that reading Mike did. I had never thought about all the ways that Jesus borrowed in his life. But it was the Lord's good plan to crush him and cause him grief. Boy, the mystery of that sentence. It was the Lord's good plan to crush him and cause him grief. When he sees all that he has accomplished by his anguish, he will be satisfied. He'll feel triumphant. And because of his experience, my righteous servant will make it possible for many to be counted righteous, for he will bear all their sins. I will give him the honors of a victorious, one could say triumphant, soldier, because he exposed himself to death. He was counted among the rebels. He bore the sins of many and interceded for rebels. So just before Jesus died, he said a phrase that is the beginning of a Good Friday-Easter continuum. These two events go together, Good Friday and Easter. And Jesus brought Easter onto the cross when he said this phrase. Jesus said, "It is finished." Would you say that with me? It is finished. Here and at home. Say it if you're at home too with us. It is finished. It looks like feeling defeated when he's on the cross, but it is actually feeling triumphant. The victory was won. Everything else, including Easter, is going to follow now. 5 or 6 years later, after this death on the cross, when he said it is finished, he met his arch enemy on earth, a man named Saul, who made it his mission in life to go round up these new Jesus followers and imprison them and kill them. And Jesus, the resurrected Christ, made his only appearance to a human being after his 40 days after his resurrection. The only time he came back one more time and met Paul on a road and said, "Paul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" He loves us so much that to persecute us is to persecute him. And this man turned from the path he was on and committed his life to Jesus and risked his life for the rest of his life to spread this news that there was a true emperor in the Roman Empire, and it wasn't the man on the throne. It was Jesus. And he wrote this to some fellow members of the Roman Empire. And when you understand the power of what he was saying, it was a very strong statement, not just spiritually, but politically. When you were dead because of the things you'd done wrong, God made you alive with Christ and forgave all the things you'd done wrong. He destroyed the record of debt we owed with its requirements that worked against us. So every time that we sin against God's commands, we go into deeper and deeper and deeper debt. And it becomes this overwhelming record. And Paul says he destroyed that. He canceled it by nailing it to the cross. When he disarmed the rulers and authorities, he exposed them to public disgrace by leading them in a triumphal parade. So there are two triumphant victory images here. The first one is an accounting one. And I don't know about you, but most of the time when I think accountants, I don't think soldiers. Seem like different people sometimes. I was a business major. I had accounting. I like counting. I like things that balance. It's good. I love it. And the amazing thing that happened on the cross, the first thing, Paul says, is this accounting transfer happened. And Jesus paid a debt he did not owe because we owed a debt that we could not pay. Jesus paid a debt he did not owe, your debt, because we, each one of us, owed a debt we could not pay. And the second image is of a triumphant parade. This is an image from the Arch of Titus, one of the emperors of Rome. And you can see that today. That's what it looks like. It's been degraded over the centuries and different things that have happened there in Rome. But this is what it looks like, an artist's rendition of what it would have looked like originally. And it's a scene of Titus, the emperor, coming back actually from conquering Jerusalem in AD 70 when the Jews revolted. And there he is, the emperor, being crowned by the goddess Victory. The horses are being led by the goddess Roma. Right beneath him is the man who has the toga that just comes up to his waist, representing the regular people of Rome. The man with the full toga is the Senate. And here he comes in, this emperor, led behind these horses. And behind him, this would have been so familiar in the first century, is all the people that he's bringing as like the first fruits of these conquered people to parade in front of Rome and say, "Look who we conquered now." That's the image that Paul is using. And everyone in the Roman Empire knew what it was to be led in a triumphant parade when you were on the back end of it. It's an image of conquest and defeat and humiliation. And Paul says, when he disarmed the rulers and authorities, he exposed them to public disgrace by leading them in a triumphal parade. The rulers and authorities is a first century way to say evil demonic forces that are opposed to us. The systems and structures we live in that are broken and sinful. The demonic energy behind them to turn us against ourselves and one another and against God. The tempters. All the things that wreak havoc in our world. And Paul says, on the cross, he disarmed them all and now marches them as the conquering emperor into God's presence. And all those forces aligned against us are humiliated and destroyed and mocked. They have no power anymore. They're prisoners. So when Jesus said, "It is finished," he was declaring victory over all that opposes us. But here's the thing. Evil forces are still aligned against us. Systems of human sin still affect us. We're oppressed from the outside. Others fail. We have external conflict. We're tempted on the inside. We fail. We have internal conflict. So what does it mean that it is finished when it doesn't really feel finished to me? When I'm still affected by the brokenness of the world, racial injustice, gender injustice, all the trauma that we go through with this disease this last year. What does it feel like to be declared that it's finished and yet our experience isn't completely there, and it won't be completely there until we either die or the Lord comes back? So I was thinking about this phrase a lot this week for me. To bring my messy in the middle to Jesus's it is finished. And just to remember in the messiness of my inner world and my outer world and my relational world, in the world that we all live in, that there's so much messiness, but it's finished. And to keep bringing my messy in the middle, my in process, my still being redeemed inner and outer things to Jesus and saying, "Jesus, I'm going to keep bringing my messy in the middle to you because you declare it is finished. There is an end to this struggle inside of me and around me, and I'm going to keep bringing that to you." So I want to give you a moment to reflect on this. Where are you most sensing the brokenness inside of you? Where are you most sensing the brokenness outside of you? I'm going to give you a moment of silence just to reflect on that. Where is it most messy inside? Where is it most messy for you outside? So Jesus, make us more and more aware of what is messy inside and messy outside, that we might keep bringing this before you and declaring over this mess that we live in, that there is an eternal hope given to us because it is finished. Well, I was looking up that phrase this week, "it is finished," I came across a song that I had never heard before, and I spent a lot of time listening to it this week, a powerful song called "It Is Finished." And it's going to lead us into communion now, so if you're at home, gather your elements. If you're here, I will just tell you, like, there's two layers of film on that little thing you picked up, so peel back the top one before you peel back the second one to get the juice, so the top one exposes the wafer. So just as we watch this video together of this song, "It Is Finished," being sung over us, let this remind you again how good it is that it is finished. And hold the elements, and we'll take them together afterwards. So Passover was a feast that reminded the Jewish people that they were slaves for 400 years. And God raised up a man named Moses, who who eventually, through a series of divine miracles, God used him to lead them out of slavery. They were pursued by their enemies, the most powerful army on earth. And God led them through a sea when their backs were against the wall. And when they got to the other side, they got to see the most powerful army on earth literally destroyed. God's enemies overtaken. They could say with Moses, "It is finished. Our slavery is over. Our enemies are defeated." It was still messy, but it was done. And they embarked on this journey, and God gave them this feast so that every year they could remember that they had to flee before their bread had time to raise with the yeast. So they ate unleavened bread, and they drank the wine of the feast as a celebration of God's blessings. And Jesus, 1,500 years into his people's annual reenactment of that experience, that it is done, it is finished, God has won, there's victory. He gathered his disciples before Good Friday that he was about to go through. And he took two of the elements from that Passover feast and gave them a new feast to celebrate forever, to remember him. And there are three time dimensions to this feast. There's a past that we now live in, where we look back at the cross like the Jewish people look back at their deliverance from Egypt, and we say, "It is finished." There's a present, where each year at Passover, they were inviting God's presence around their table and saying, "You're with us now, here in the messy middle." And there is also coming a day, Jesus said, when we take this feast, that we remember that he's coming again. That it won't always be messy in the middle. That the "it is finished" will be completely done someday. He will return and make all things right. And so we look back, we experience him now, we look forward in faith. And so, before you take the bread with me, Jesus took the bread and said, "This is my body broken for you." And I want you to say with me, "It is finished." And then he took the cup and said, "This cup is my blood given for you to forgive your sins." And before you take and drink, say with me, "It is finished." So Act 3, credited as a coming king on Palm Sunday, crushed as a common criminal on Good Friday, crowned as a conquering Christ, Messiah. Jesus didn't just overcome death, he began to flip the scripts that humans had created, narratives of exclusion. You may not see this as clearly coming from our culture, where things are a little different. How many of you ladies would agree it's still harder to be a woman than a man today? A couple of you. The rest of you are like, uh-huh. First people he appeared to that Easter morning were people who couldn't testify in a court of law. If you were a woman in the first century, you were considered an unreliable witness, too emotional. Can't give reliable testimony in court. So what does Jesus do when he comes back from the dead? He starts flipping scripts of what people think about the world. And he first appears to women, who in the culture would not be accepted as witnesses. And he says, guess what? You're my witnesses. Mary Magdalene is at the tomb and she's weeping because the body isn't there, because guess what? I love that little video of the text messages, but that was none of the disciples' first response. He's risen, yeah! They're all like, mm-mm. People don't come back from the dead. There's this modern narrative we have that, like, those people just wanted to believe and that's why they created all this. No, like, read the New Testament. None of them wanted it, expected it, believed it. They had to be convinced over and over again. So here's this person shuffling in the garden and dawn, the first rays of light starting to break forth. Mary thinks it's the gardener. Where have you put him? Where is he? Where's the body? And he says, Mary. And she hears his voice. And she knows it's Jesus. Rabboni, she says, teacher. And he says to her, you now go back and tell the dudes. You're my first witness. I'm making a woman the first witness of the new world that's been created by my resurrection. You go tell the dudes. She goes, tells the dudes. They run to the tomb like, that's really weird. He's not here. That night he appears to them. They're like, what? You walk through a door? Can we touch you? You're real? One of them's not there, Thomas. He gets back. They tell him, dude, Jesus walked through a door. We touched him. Yeah, no. That's crazy. What is it, April Fools? What's going on here? No, I'm not going to believe that till I touch the wounds in his hands and feel his scars. He really did. No. Next Sunday, Thomas gets part of the party as well. He appeared over and over and over and over again for 40 days until they were finally convinced over everything that made sense to them before that. A human being really came back from the dead, not just a little while, not just a miracle of resuscitation, a resurrection. He's the first of a whole new class of things that are going to happen. The whole world changed. But even then, they still didn't get it. They still said to him in Acts 1, like, okay, so when are you going to set up the kingdom and rule from Israel and make us the greatest people on earth? And Jesus is like, no, you still don't get it. You think because you're the chosen people, you're God's favorite people, that he loves you the most. No, no. You're going to go to Samaritans and tell them this good news. What? You're going to go to Gentiles and tell them this good news. We're flipping scripts, guys. Women are at the top. Non-Jews are at the top. Everybody's going to be like seen on this new plane of reality. And these systems that we create to make people different and oppressed, Jesus flipped them over. So it wasn't just coming back from the dead, it was changing the systems we live in. Amazing stuff started happening. Paul talks in Philippians 2, not just about the resurrection where he gets to, but beyond that. So Philippians 2, though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. We think it's pretty cool to be human, but can you imagine like the step down that was for God? Celebrate that at Christmas, the incarnation, God becoming flesh to live among us. And human beings, fallen human beings anyway, who our orientation is always to protect our rights. And God shows us to be the best human being is to yield your privileges to serve other people. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. Therefore, God elevated him to the place of highest honor and gave him the name above all other names, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue declare that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. That phrase, it is finished, is the hinge point of human history, and it started on the cross but continued and was fulfilled on Easter Sunday. But there's even more beyond that. So if you look at the arc of Jesus' experience as a human being, it looks like this. He comes in an incarnation, an enfleshing. He does his ministry. He's betrayed by one of his closest friends, abandoned by the rest of them. He experiences injustice, a crucifixion. And on that cross, just before he dies, he says, "It is finished." And then he resurrects. And then in Acts 1, it says he ascends up to heaven, and his disciples who've been watching him, seeing him over and over and over again for 40 days, who finally believe he came back from the dead, see him leave. And the Bible teaches that he's enthroned now next to the Father, still in a human body, in some mysterious way, fully God, fully human, just like he was here. And we will see him one day, and he's enthroned. And one of the things he does from his throne is he prays for you all the time. One of the amazing things is that as a human being, we're so limited. We can pray for one person at a time. Jesus can pray for everyone in this room, everyone all over the world, everyone who's ever lived, everyone who's going to live. And his thoughts and intentions toward you are non-stop bringing you before the Father, saying, "Father, I love this one. Would you bring blessing and goodness and help them in their messy in the middle to believe that it is finished?" He will one day return. We may be alive, we may not. And he will reign forever and ever and ever over a new heaven and a new earth, and we'll have new bodies just like the one he had, and we will live with him forever, and we will have the most fulfilling human experience that we can't even dream of how amazing it's going to be, because it all started then when he said it's finished. When he said that, he looked forward to eternity with us, not just singing worship songs, but being on a new earth and living fulfilled lives, doing things that we were meant to do, to rule and reign with him forever. So I wonder if there's someone here or maybe at home, and you have yet to bring your messy individual and outside self to Jesus to seek his forgiveness and to ask for him to help you to experience more and more of the good things he wants you to have in life that come from following him, to stop being the sheep that runs away looking for things to fulfill you outside of him, and to start saying, "I believe you're a shepherd who wants good things for me. I'll follow you now. I'll listen to your voice." So all of us need to come back every day, but maybe there's some who haven't made that surrender choice yet. And if that's you, I'm just gonna pray in a moment. If it helps you, you can pray along with me. They're not magic words. But at home or here, you can pray with me. So Jesus, thank you for coming to this earth, living a perfect life, dying on a cross, paying my debt that you didn't know, coming back from the dead, that it is finished, and I can have hope with you forever. Would you forgive me for the ways that I've strayed, trying to find life and meaning and joy in places that will never provide it? Forgive me for hurting myself, other people, and most importantly, you. And would you forgive my sins? Would you send your Holy Spirit to dwell inside of me so that I can be led and begin to listen to your voice more, the voice of a shepherd saying, "Come this way. I have good water for you, good pasture. Rest here with me. Let me bless you. Let me fill you." So thank you for wanting that for me, and I just say yes today. Amen. Would you stand with me, please? And when we get to the last three words of this benediction, I want you to say them with me. I'll begin praying over you and you finish with me. So you can go to that slide now. May you go forth with resurrected Easter courage, knowing that whatever you face outside of you or inside of you, you have ultimate hope because Jesus has already won the victory for you and it is finished. Happy Easter.
I believe in the sun. I believe.